Hey guys, David Kwan here. I'm here to talk about the game Sonic Dash, which I've been playing on my iPhone 4. First of all, this is a game where it's just like, Sega, what took you so long? It makes so much sense to have made this in the first place so long ago. You know, I mean, endless runners for now have been quite a thing. Games like Subway Surfer, Asian Dash, Temple Run, they've been around for a long time now. There's not even a Temple Run 2, you know, and endless runners are like one of the biggest genres on mobile devices. Makes a lot of sense. I enjoy endless runners quite a bit, and then I've always wondered why there wasn't a Sonic one, because it makes so much sense. Sonic is now all the a lot of the modern Sonic games are where you're just kind of pushing forward for like jumping over obstacles, jumping to enemies. You have the homing run attack, homing attack. Just makes so much sense. So it's really like, really Sega, it took you this long, and the first game you had on an iOS device, an original game, was Sonic Jump, which is kind of, you just kind of tilt your iPhone like side to the side to make Sonic jump, which is a clone of another type of game. So already that was a clone. This one is like a really, it borrows a lot of features from, it's more like Subway Surfer than like Temple Run. Temple Run, you use the gyroscope to swipe left and right, and then you tilt left and right to on the side. So that's Temple Run type of game. Subway Surfer is you swipe to change lanes, and that's pretty much it. And so that's Sonic, and then you jump up or you roll down. That's pretty much Sonic Dash. You change lanes and you jump up or you roll down to do the spin dash attack, which makes you go underneath obstacles. And the same perk system from Subway Surfer is in Sonic Dash, where you have the missions and you have to complete each level. Each time you level up, you get a higher multiplier for accruing your points. And you can't level up unless you complete all three missions of that level. So that's pretty much exactly like Subway Surfer. So a lot of the barring mechanics, the one thing that separates Sonic Dash from every other endless runner is what it does with rings. Usually in other endless runners, you have gems or coins that you collect, and then you just accrue it during a run. You finish a run, you use that run on the game's store, and you buy upgrades, buy abilities, or upgrade your abilities, buy items, buy characters, stuff like that. In Sonic Dash, the rings you collect, you can actually lose it during the middle of the run if you run into an enemy or into a spike. And so you lose, if you have like 50 rings or 100 rings, it doesn't matter. If you hit an enemy, you lose all of that. So that's why in the game, there's certain breaks in Sonic Dash where you can use a spring, and there's a coin icon or ring icon, and if you hit that, you bank your rings, so that in that course of the ring, in the course of the run, those rings will be stored. So no matter what happens afterwards, you'll end the run with that amount of rings at least. So there's that kind of risk reward feature that they put in, but it doesn't really work that well. It's the one thing that makes it unique, one thing that makes Sonic Dash one of the most hardcore endless runners out there. It's a very frustratingly challenging game. This is the endless runner that sometimes made me want to just like throw the iPhone out there, because it made me so mad. And that has to do with this, the placement of the obstacles and the enemies are cheap. There's a lot of cheap deaths in Sonic Dash, and this isn't the type of the game where the controls are extremely responsive either. It's kind of sloppy compared to the other endless runners like Subway Surfer and like Asian Dash, which are like one of the best endless runner games of this type. I prefer more the Temple Run, but since Sonic Dash is more like Subway Surfer than like Temple Run, the controls on Subway Surfer are super, super responsive, and usually when I mess up, when I die on Subway Surfer, that's my fault entirely. Sonic Dash, not necessarily the case. The obstacles are placed in such a way, it's so cheap. I keep forgetting, there's this part where there's like three pillars, right? And if you jump over the middle pillar, there's an enemy right there that when you land, you hit that enemy. So I have to keep remembering to choose the other pillars to jump over. It's that kind of placement where you have to memorize the rote rote memorization of the placement of the obstacles and the enemies. It's frustrating. Why design an endless runner like that? It's just, it's designed so that a player grows to become good at it through trial and error, which is unusual in this genre for mobile devices. So Sonic Dash is like one of the only endless runner that actually does this. It sets it apart. It gives a lot of challenge. It makes you actually like rememorize the game. So for those that stick around, like it can be quite rewarding, but you have to stick around. And I can imagine a lot of people just kind of quitting at the first like 10 minutes or so. As a matter of fact, the first 10 minutes, I was actually struggling to figure out the homing attack. It took me to figure out like how to do that. It doesn't actually like explain well that you have to just tap on the fish right after you jump, and you have to wait a while and then tap on the fish and then do a homing attack. But it doesn't really explain all that well. So there's the cheapness and the reward risk management. Like if it wasn't so cheap, the whole reward risk mechanic with the rings would have been pretty cool. But because it's so cheaply placed, most of the time, unless you're not trying to complete a mission for the level, the safest bet is to just bank the coins. Just get the, just accrue the coins up there. But some of the missions in this game to level up are pretty ridiculous. They're really, really challenging. I think the hardest one for me was, and I think a lot of people would agree, is getting hit 20 times in a row by an enemy. So that means I had to get hit, collect some rings, get hit, collect some rings, and survive that, the whole run, for 20 times in a row. That was super hard. And I've only managed to be able to do that because and this borrows from Temple Run 2 feature where you can use the second currency to revive your character from death during the middle of the run. And the more times you die, the more expensive it becomes. And the second currency in this game is the Red Ring, or the red token, and they can be used to buy, to upgrade, to buy to revive your characters, and to buy characters. In my opinion, as is the most cases with these kinds of games, the in-game the pricing of the in-game purchases, are just in-app purchases IAP, are ridiculously overpriced. It takes 30 tokens to buy Amy a character. Spending $6 will grant you 60 tokens. So you can buy Amy, I think, but that's pretty much it. Or Tails, I think, is 50 tokens. And then you have like 10 tokens you can use. It's extremely expensive if you want to buy any characters. And from what I've seen, there's no differentiation between what characters you choose. Whatever. So, as a whole concept, I know I'm sounding like I'm really hating on this game, but I'm glad I bought the game for $2, just because I agree with the concept that an endless runner featuring Sonic makes sense. Makes a lot of sense. It's actually been a lot of fun, although I've had a lot of frustrating hair-pulling moments with this game than any other endless runner out there. It looks quite nice. It's very nostalgic in the sense that it is 3D graphics. It looks very nice. It features Green Hill Zone and the first zone from Sonic Adventure. So it uses those two zones as the backdrop, which looks quite nice on the iPhone 4. And I've seen footage of the iPad version, which looks amazing. I wish my version looked like that instead of this. But not a graphics horror. It still looks pretty good. It's very nostalgic in that matter. I just feel like Sega missed a huge opportunity here. I mean, it just makes so much sense. They took this long to actually produce, like make it and release it. They could have done something so much more with this endless runner. Make it like one of the most unique ones out there. Go all out. Like bring out the abilities that are only unique to Sonic characters. Make each characters with different abilities. Have, bubble shields that are totally missing in this game. Even maybe, like, include boss fights in this endless runner, which would make it one of the first for an endless runner. have it like maybe at random sections. You have to like fight a boss. Different Robotnik machine comes in and you fight that along the way. Would have been amazing. This thing could have been like one of the most amazing thing on the Apple Store. But as it is, it's a decent Sonic Endless Runner game. It's one we've been one I've been waiting for. One I think that makes a lot of sense. Right now, it's a fun, decent purchase that I'm glad I made. But I just feel like Sega could have done so much more. And maybe when they do like Sonic Dash 2, they could implement some of those crazy cool ideas for this game.